This is The Wheelhouse on Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil.
This toll bill has been bought and paid for by taxpayers' money.
Bolton reportedly said he heard President Trump call for withholding aid to Ukraine until former Vice President Joe Biden was investigated.
We are getting breaking news. Norm Pattis is now saying that Fotis Doulos has a pulse.
That's all coming up and more. Again, I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. My panelists today, I want to welcome into our studio Caitlin Krassel, political reporter for Hearst Connecticut Media. Caitlin, welcome back.
Thanks for having me.
Also, Kevin Rennie, Hartford Current columnist and former state lawmaker. Kevin, nice to see you.
Thank you. It's very nice to be here.
And of course, Colin McEnroe, host of the Colin McEnroe Show. Hi, Colin.
Good morning, Lucy.
So later this week, we're hearing the public will finally get a hearing on this latest transportation bill that outlines trucks only tolls, a key part of Governor Lamont's 10-year, $19 billion infrastructure plan. Now, will lawmakers squeak in a vote before next Wednesday? That's the start of the 2020 legislative session. We're going to talk about that and also preview some proposals that may come up before lawmakers over the next 3 months. You can join us, too. Tweet us at WMPR Wheelhouse. So we wanted to change things up and actually talk about impeachment first. And so, Colin, what is the latest now that there was that bombshell with the details from John Bolton's book being released earlier?
Right. Obviously, that creates more pressure to call witnesses. It also creates a certain amount of ill will among senators who feel a little bit blindsided by this. They dislike that about as much as they dislike anything. Having a game plan in which a crucial piece of information is omitted, in this case, the fact that, A, the White House had this book for vetting. A lot of people, by the way, would have had to look at that book under those circumstances, I assume, including Pat Cipollone's White House counsel. I don't know how he wouldn't have seen that book. So for a senator to not have known that that was out there, that that was available, I think that does create ill will. On the other hand, and I think we may all see this a little bit differently. I parse Mitch McConnell's words very carefully, you know, and when he says something like, I don't have the votes to block a call for witnesses, that's a little bit different, I think, to me anyway, than there are enough votes to call witnesses. That means there are people sitting on the fence. There are people that he feels he doesn't have sufficient clarity on, and that statement could be true if the only people he was sure wanted to call witnesses were, for example, Susan Collins and Mitt Romney and Lisa Murkowski, and they'd still be one short. You know, he could still truthfully say, I don't have enough solid votes to block witnesses. The question is, which way does he really think this is going to come out? And I don't know why I'm saying this exactly, but I actually think, absent some other kind of carrot, some kind of inducement, some reason why a bunch of other Republicans would want to open the floodgates here, it might be the case that he really can still block the calling of these witnesses.
Kevin Reddy, what do you think in terms of inducements? Is Hunter Biden someone that the GOP really wants to have testify?
I doubt that they really want to have him testify because he might turn out to be a credible witness and have nothing to do with corruption, which then – and he's certainly well-educated. I'm going to assume that he would be – that he would be an articulate witness. And so I don't think that they would really want him to be a witness. But the pool of potential Senate Republicans to vote for witnesses at least to get to 51 – it's not a very big pool, but if they can get to 51, then they may have a lot more than 51. Others may, you know, for instance, Rob Portman, if he were not the critical vote, he might vote for witnesses. Some of the others who are retiring might do the same thing, but they do need to get to 51, and I imagine poor Lamar Alexander is under tremendous pressure from his friend Mitch McConnell, and I do think that sometimes we don't see the power of individual friendships that form over the years. And for instance, when they're running or running for the first time or running for re-election, the millions of dollars that these leaders pour into their campaigns, give them a sense of obligation and form some bonds that that are not obvious in public. Hmm.
Caitlin, what about the argument that the Senate Republicans and even Mr. Trump's attorneys are making that if you really wanted to have these witnesses testify, it should have been done previously before the House? Does that really carry any weight, considering that I think John Bolton, they weren't even going to cooperate with the House at the time?
Yeah, they're basing it on a set of rules that were used during the Clinton impeachment, but there's nothing that says they can't make new rules. And they'll even admit that. So the idea that they can't call any witnesses that weren't called in the House is kind of silly.
I do want to say, I think they may have made a mistake to your question. I think it may have been an error in the House not to pursue these witnesses, not to take the time to try to get them, because it really does ultimately, I think, seriously weaken the obstruction argument. You know, it was sort of like, well, we said we wanted these witnesses. The president said we couldn't have them, so we just gave up. Whereas, you know, we fought this guy tooth and nail and maybe got the witnesses for that matter. I sensed at the time that maybe they wanted to make – it's almost maybe like they didn't want to win in court, because then you can't make the obstruction argument as easily if you get the witnesses that you were asking for, courtesy of the Supreme Court. I think that might turn out to be a little bit of a blunder to not have done that at the House level. I just quickly also want to point out, I mean, you know, for whatever it's worth, the national polling on this intensifies. Q poll just dropped something new, which is that people are like 75-20, mm-hmm. 75-20 in favor of calling witnesses. Now, that's an interesting thing. I don't think it's a sort of march on City Hall issue for a lot of people. It's like you ask them what they think, you know. Oh, yeah, I think they should call witnesses. But it's not something people are necessarily willing to die on the cross over. And I also think, you know, you also have to get kind of granular on this. It's a pretty big national phenomenon that people think there should be witnesses. How big a phenomenon is it in the home state of Doug Jones, Alabama? You know, you still want to know those things too.
That's an interesting point. When I looked at that poll, I wanted to see, you know, how many registered Republicans think that more witnesses should be called before the Senate impeachment trial. I think it was 49%. But when you look at approval ratings, I believe it's like in the 90s of Republicans that are supporting the president's job. And so, Kevin, that's what these Republican lawmakers are thinking about, especially the 35, I believe, that are going to be up for election in 2020.
Oh, they're constantly calculating what each vote, what each statement makes. But I do think they have to confront this, which is that most Americans think, well, why wouldn't you want witnesses? And I mean, you have witnesses in an automobile accident case. Why? You certainly would want some witnesses in the impeachment of the president of the United States. It just seems. And then, of course, we see that there is more news. There's more evidence to be tested under oath with John Bolton.
And Caitlin, I mentioned that it was a bombshell, because this, you know, again, John Bolton saying in his book that he was in the room, he heard the president saying that he wanted the Ukraine to investigate before this money would be let go. I mean, that's a pretty big deal. It's not circumstantial.
It's not. The thing that's interesting to me is that when you look back at the timeline of John Bolton leaving his position and then the news about this apparent phone call and withholding aid from Ukraine, it all kind of lines up. So I guess, was it really that surprising? I don't know. I mean, he was the national security advisor. So he should have known something, right? Mm-hmm. That's his job. So it's interesting to me that it's being portrayed as such a huge bombshell mm-hmm. when –
Well, and we
should have known something.
Yeah, we know via Fiona Hill. She's the one who at before the House committee said gave us the information that Bolton called this a drug deal and had objected to it. And it seemed as though, to your point, Caitlin, this might have been the last straw. You know, it had been a rocky relationship between Trump and Bolton. There were a whole bunch of things they didn't agree about, but this might have been what did the whole thing in, particularly because Bolton was very uncomfortable with Giuliani's role in orchestrating based on no official position, orchestrating foreign policy there. So, yeah, I mean, I think it is clear. I think there was a period of time where people thought, oh, what if he's a Trojan horse, you know? What if he's a guy who's sending out signals that he didn't like any of this and he's got something to say? And then because he's a very loyal Republican, I mean, he's an unflinchingly loyal Republican, what if he gets up there and goes, says, oh, no, the president behaved
not
perfectly.
Not one word.
Honorably. But I feel like that's gone now. That's just not a possibility.
They weren't going to give him a big book contract to say, no, he never said a word.
Yeah.
But the Trump defenders do keep saying, well, there's no evidence. There have been no witnesses who heard the president say it. Well, there haven't been because they blocked all those witnesses. So now here's the chance to hear them.
Say there is a vote and, you know, miraculously there are enough votes to call witnesses like John Bolton. What happens then? Are we looking at a long court battle from the White House to keep him from testifying, Kevin?
I doubt it. I doubt that they want to extend this. What they would have at first was there would be private depositions basically of John Bolton and then a representative from the White House would be there to object to questions that have national security implications. So I do think that could extend it because then those might become the subject of court decisions and controversies. But we certainly would hear, I think, through leaks, some of what he said.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and then I think – you know, if it becomes a court battle, it'll be a fairly quick court battle. I would assume the Supreme Court will grant cert immediately.
The Chief Justice of the United States.
Chief Justice has a foot in both rooms here at this point. He doesn't want this thing dragging on because it keeps him. You know, there's nothing about John Roberts that makes me think he wants to be sitting there in the Senate day after day after day. He would like this to be over so he could get back to doing what he likes to do, which is run the Supreme Court. So, I mean, he has a powerful incentive to get this resolved. And we've just seen it in the past. These things, because they tend to freeze the entire national narrative until they're decided. So I can't remember how quickly the Nixon case was decided. It was decided 8-0, and I think it was decided pretty quickly. We saw it here in Connecticut with Roland, where Roland and his wife refused a subpoena, went to the Supreme Court to try to block it. And I think that was
very quick.
That was like 48 hours.
Yeah, that was very quick. That was not as quick as the That was quicker than the Nixon.
Yeah.
The Nixon tapes went on for months.
Right.
But it was during that time that the impeachment articles were voted on in the House Judiciary.
And there's more, you know, there's more precedent. I mean, you could argue that there's sort of stare decisis already on this that might make it a little bit faster too. In other words, the Supremes don't have a welter of conflicting opinions to look at on this question. The overwhelming body of decisions that precede this would favor disclosure of anything that's not classified information.
I thought an interesting statistic that C-SPAN was following, that the House managers used just under 22 of their 24 hours over the last 3 days, while the White House team used just half their time, about 12 hours. I was thinking, if you follow football, the time of possession, although that stat doesn't really mean anything. As we know, we still need those four senators to vote to get those witnesses. So we'll have to see. Colin, you also host, pardon me, an impeachment podcast. So what are you going to be looking at this week?
Well, obviously, we are going to be looking at all of this. I feel like it's one of our guests is going to be Mike Pesca, who hosts The Gist over on Slate. And one of the reasons I wanted to talk to Mike is Mike has sort of a natural kind of game theory mind. And we are kind of at the point – we've spent a lot of time on, pardon me, talking to legal scholars who have been very, very useful and helpful to us, up to and including Michael Gerhardt, one of the legal scholars who testified to the House. But I think we're down to game theory now. You know, it really is more of a question of some of the things that Kevin was bringing up too, that people are weighing their electoral possibilities, the negative consequences of doing something that works against the fate of President Trump. These are a lot of the things that are coming into play.
This is The Wheelhouse. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. With me, Colin McEnroe, host of The Colin McEnroe Show, Kevin Rennie, Hartford current columnist and former state lawmaker, and Caitlin Kresselt, a Kresselt political reporter for Hearst Connecticut Media. Coming up, we're going to turn our attention to Connecticut, and we're going to hear about tolls yet again. Stay with us. This is The Wheelhouse on Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. On Monday, the Democrats released text of the bill for trucks-only tolls after the governor announced an agreement on a bond package. A public hearing will be held this Friday, and a vote in special session could come Monday or Tuesday. That's right before the regular session that starts on Wednesday. My panelists here, Caitlin Krassel, political reporter for Hearst, Connecticut, Kevin Rennie, Hartford Current columnist, and of course, Colin McInerney. We'll start with you, Caitlin. You've been covering this latest tolls proposal, the fact that the text of the bill is finally out. So what do we need to know about it?
There's a few things to know about it. The first, I think the biggest thing is that is creating a little bit of controversy is who would set the rates of the tolls. This bill would create a council of 12 people, I believe, that would have that authority, which seems to grind the gears of many of the legislators who believe that that should be their duty and power to do so. So that's one thing. And then the other thing that is confusing to me, having not covered these things in the past, and I think to the general public, is how exactly it would prevent the expansion of tolls to cars in the future. And it seems through this so-called bond covenant, essentially a promise that it would not expand tolls to cars for at least 2 years, but I think up to 10. It's a little bit unclear. And some people tend to believe that that's not necessarily true because the bondholders, it would be in their interest to expand cars because they want more money.
So, Kevin, I mentioned you're a former lawmaker, state lawmaker. So is it problematic that this potential transportation council will be the ones deciding about rates?
Oh, it is.
Versus legislature.
It is because, there are two ways to look at this. One is a legislator, if tolls go up, legislators can say, well, we don't have anything to do with that. And but on the other hand, they do want to have something to do with that if they think that they will be held accountable for toll increases. And I also think in the back of their minds, there is a sense that if the toll on trucks only does not withstand scrutiny, that we will not have no tolls. It will expand to motor to cars, and then they really would need to worry about the impact of a unaccountable board raising tolls.
Mm. Colin, I mentioned that to get this bill ready for a potential vote early next week, governor had to be in agreement with lawmakers related to bonding. So what do you think of that agreement? And of course, Senate Republican leader Len Fasano is saying that Lamont's buying votes.
Duh. But I mean, obviously, there a governor has not lived in my lifetime who was not willing to use bonding money to buy votes. I mean, that's kind – it's not what it's for, but it is what it's for in the sense that this is the surgical strike money that you can use, that you can direct at a specific lawmaker whom you need. In other words, you're not offering to build a school in all 169 towns. You're offering to build a school in that person's district. So, I mean, when you have that kind of money and you have problems, you have a recalcitrant legislature, you're going to use it. Now, you know, I mean, I think one of the things that Ned Lamont has struggled a little bit with is overpromising. So his initial promise, as I understand it, was that the debt diet, the so-called debt diet, would have a debt ceiling of $960 million. And that has crept up, not surprisingly, but it has crept up. So it's now being – maybe I'm not understanding something, in which case I would get a phone call from Max Reese apparently. But if I'm understanding this correctly, that's where we started. And then it went up to 1.4 and now it's going up to 1.7. But it could be argued that this is not a $300 million increase. It is a considerably larger increase.
From where he started. Yes.
Yeah, from the starting line. But a little of that's overpromising too. I mean, I think to sort of say, coming into this as a blushing bride of a governor, I'm going to hold a bonding that low, I don't think he understood what he was promising or whether it was possible to deliver on that promise. So he's got a little bit of an issue there. I just want to quickly sort of add to what Kevin and Caitlin were saying. You know, I mean, I hate these quasi-publics and weird little unaccountable councils of hooded figures and stuff. And so I don't like this either. Although the way that it looked to me, and this is also subject to endless discussion and amendment, but the way that it looked to me, DOT would actually, I think, have the power to trigger an increase that was based on inflation. And if they went higher than that, then the Council of Hooded Figures would step in and either approve or not approve. I may have that wrong, but because I don't really favor handing it back to, you know, 187 yo-yos over there who
– the elected representatives of the people.
Yes, those people. Yeah, well, they can't order lunch, Kevin. So, I mean, letting them fly-spec something as minute as a rate increase strikes me as an – that could take 5 years.
Well, we're letting
years.
Them do something considerably bigger than a rate increase.
No, I know. But, that, you know, I just – that seems unwieldy. I understand why you would want to have something a little bit more agile than the state legislature deal with something like this. But at the same time, I don't like these weird little councils.
Caitlin, does Colin have that right in terms of when these rates would go up going over to this suggested council?
That is my understanding. It is a little bit confusing. The initial rate would be set by the transportation commissioner, and then he or she would have the authority to propose rate increases, and then that would have to be approved by the council. That's the way that I understand it. The council also is tasked with approving a 5-year transportation capital plan, which is a new thing as well. And that essentially would just be saying, like, these are the projects that we're going to use the money for. And they would work with the Department of Transportation to come up with that.
Kevin Redding, can we go back to what Caitlin brought up earlier? And that is this the bond covenant and keeping these tolls off of cars in the future. Can you break that down for us and how the bill is written?
I think we should remember this. Trucks only is what Governor Lamont campaigned on. So in this now, in its current configuration, he has some credibility in saying, this is what I said, even though I said many things in between before we got back to this point. So I do think there is some sympathy for, or maybe some support on the bill based on that. But one of the great hurdles, probably maybe the greatest hurdle, is public mistrust of state government that continues to grow in Connecticut. And people simply do not believe that this will ultimately be a trucks-only program of tolls. And so whatever's in that bond covenant, they could find ways to make adjustments, I believe. And for instance, one way would be refinance the bonds. If there's a covenant in the bonds that they don't like, we've refinanced bonds all the time, and that would take that out of there, and you get new legislation, and you can expand. You can expand the universe of tolls to everybody.
Here's the thing, though: if they had the votes to pass broad tolling on cars, they would have done that, right?
Yes,
that was proposed, and so at a certain point, it's
what
like
I mean is in the future, the public mistrusting state government. I think they may not believe that it is really locked in that this will be trucks only into the foreseeable future.
Right. It's hard for me. They could do that anyway, right? Like every 2 years,
yes,
a new body is elected.
Yes.
They could do that anyway.
You're both right. It's political poison for them, obviously. Yeah. They can barely get the votes for trucks. It's not even clear they do have the votes for truck tolls at this point. So you're absolutely correct. It's a political reality. It can't happen. But Kevin is also correct that a covenant shmovenant. That means absolutely
right. You just
nothing.
You can't take comfort in that.
No.
Yeah. Going back to what you said, Kevin, about public mistrust, this has been a largely a partisan issue. No Republicans in the legislature are supporting now even trucks-only tolls. But does that – when we think about the general public in the state of Connecticut, is it the mistrust just largely Republican or is it across the board?
Oh, no. I think it is. I think it's widespread. And it doesn't necessarily negate people's partisan loyalties, but I do think that – that there is widespread mistrust of state government, of government, not just state government, but probably federal government too, and that crosses party lines. And it's often well founded in Connecticut. I can tell you, when I was in the legislature, I think it was my first year, I remember seeing someone who was absolutely opposed to a $1 billion tax increase for deficit at the time walk off the floor of the House with a leader and come back supporting it and having gotten bleachers for his high school football field. And that was the price for a $1 billion to vote for a $1 billion tax increase. And we all saw it. And what is remarkable is how little a vote can be bought for.
Caitlin, Colin mentioned it's still not quite clear if there are enough votes to get this whole transportation bill passed in this special session. I mean, what are you hearing at the Capitol?
I am hearing that they have the votes, especially in the Senate. It's a little more unclear in the House, but I assume that if they're the House had a significant role in writing this bill, and if they're bringing it up and they're talking about a special session, they have the votes.
Yeah, if they're spending this money, presumably, if they're spending this money and they don't have the votes, they really are a bunch of idiots.
Yeah.
But I assume that at this point that the bonding money will make this a reality. But it's been – like last week, they didn't have it. You know, I mean, it was pretty clear that they didn't have clear consensus that they could get this thing passed.
And it's been thought – Caitlin, maybe you could – well, tell me if I'm right or wrong, but it's been – Through this year of this whole told saga, it's been thought that the House was going to be – it was going to be easier to get the votes in the House than in the Senate. Mm-hmm. And now it appears that the Senate is locked in, but they're not as sure about the House.
Yeah. Hmm. Yeah, that's true. It's also – the Senate, it's unclear how locked in it is, right? Because Senator Looney came out whenever that caucus was – I guess 2 weeks ago now, and his quote, you know, we have a contingent consensus of 18 not no votes or something along those lines. So I assume that means that they have 18 yes votes now, which that obviously would require a tie-breaking vote from the lieutenant governor.
Tolista will have to be told.
Which is like
– Can I say one last thing about this? I do think it's kind of hilarious now that the gantries are apparently located right on or at the entry point to the bridges in question, right? It's like, you want to drive across this bridge? You don't want it to fall down? All right. You want us to use Wikipedia when we fix it? All right. Then give us some money.
We were talking about bonding. Kevin, how much of pressure did these lawmakers get from their constituencies, hearing about, borrowing, being tied up that would really help municipalities deal with even their road projects and snow removal?
They probably hear from people who are active in town government. But I don't think that the general public is that engaged in the details of what roads are going to be fixed. Mm-hmm. Because there are going to be tolls on trucks. There are state programs for repairing and maintaining local roads. But also, a lot of towns contribute significant amounts from local tax that are collected there to maintain roads.
Caitlin Krasseld, again, who's with the political reporter for Hearst Connecticut Media. You've been covering tolls. But there is, again, a regular session starting next Wednesday, a short session, only 3 months. So what are some things that we should be watching?
It seems like a lot of big priorities for them center around public health proposals. So obviously one of the big things that they've talked about is figuring out a way to control the price of insulin and other prescription drugs. That's a big priority and something that's being talked about nationally. A variety of other healthcare-related proposals are on the list there. They are bringing up the legalization of recreational cannabis again. I'm told historically that this is something that's been talked about in the past is, this will definitely be the year that they do it. And so, everyone's a little bit skeptical. It does seem as though because public approval for legalization has moved so far in favor that at this point it's not whether or not they should legalize it, but how and what that should look like. And that seems to be the real point of contention on that particular issue. Mm. I'm trying to think of what else. There's so many things.
sports betting, Kevin?
Oh, yeah.
Well, probably not.
Okay.
Because – we have this issue with the tribes that have a monopoly on gaming, and or certain types of gaming. And so they're claiming that they have a that the legalizing sports gambling would violate their compact with the state of Connecticut. So that is a very complicated issue. And what I've noticed over the years is in January, there are always all sorts of high hopes and many proposals for what we're going to accomplish in this short session. And most of them do not live past the initial press conferences or public hearings. That this the compressed session really makes it very easy to kill bills and a lot harder to have a bill make it all the way in to the governor's desk.
And there used to be sort of putative rules about what you could bring up in the short session. It used to be fiscal only, right?
The short session was the constitution. I think maybe even the constitutional amendment or the statutes that went with it were that the short session was a budget session because previously we'd only had sessions in the odd number of years. Mm-hmm. Well, that has changed.
Yeah.
Although so this year –
there was almost like a covenant not to do that.
Yes. Not almost to, like a covenant. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Yes.
And look what happened.
That all we all relied on.
So, Colin, you know, I'm just curious what you're going to be watching again. As Kevin mentioned, there may not be much that comes out of this session.
Right. And because it's a short session and because the fiscal problems loom large – there probably shouldn't be a lot. You know, Alex Bergstein has a piece, an op-ed piece in the Hearst papers. She's a senator from Greenwich saying, you know, that some of the stuff is too reckless. She thinks marijuana, total marijuana legalization is too reckless. Some of the stuff is not comprehensive enough. I guess the thing that I, one of the things I'm the most interested in, I think this is like a 2-3 year process as opposed to something they can do in this session. But Josh Elliott and some other legislators are trying to figure out if there's a way to work with other states to develop an interstate compact where we're not doing this constant race to the bottom in order to compete for business relocation. So in other words, you know, how many incentives can we steer your way? How can we, you know, and the problem, of course, with it is that the United States has turned into essentially 50 gas stations, each one trying to post the lowest price to get you to take your business there. And that's not a good way for state governments to run. Even if we could do this, even if they could do this with some surrounding states and sort of take a little bit of that pressure off and agree that, wow, there's a certain you know, interest we might have collectively in having a healthy business climate without constantly having to, you know, create these incentives, which I think leave a bitter taste in a lot of people's mouths. I think that's the one that intrigues me at the moment anyway.
You know, we're focusing on what's going to happen in the legislative session, but just, you know, outside of that, Kevin Rennie, a lot of these lawmakers up for reelection in the fall. So what are they doing right now to help those campaigns?
They are raising money from lobbyists. There, we do have a public financing, campaign financing system that was intended to end what's going on right now, which is the calendar is crowded with fundraising events that legislators are sponsoring. A lot of mostly Democratic legislators have created their own political action committees. So they're raising money from lobbyists and their clients through those. And there are I believe in the next few days there are days when you might be able to go to respond to 10 invitations with contributions. And then because there may be a special session next week and you're not allowed to raise money from lobbyists during the during a session, at least until the regular session ends this year, they had to change dates. A lot of these fundraisers had to be moved into this week from next week because if there's a special session going on, they would not be able to hold those fundraisers. And the public financing system really has just become an extra arm to what is now the lobbyist finance system. And this was not supposed to happen. And we've spent probably at this point, well, certainly hundreds of millions of dollars in public funds for campaigns. And it has not done what it was intended to do.
Colin?
Oh, first of all, I would agree with most of what my colleague just said. I mean, it has not cleansed the temple. What public financing has done is create opportunities for candidates who might not otherwise have been able to run. It probably – I don't know if I've seen a statistical analysis of this, but I would say probably at this point in the rollout of public financing, I wouldn't be surprised to see that we have, for example, maybe more women in the state legislature. Some of the other groups of people that might have found it hard to get through the door. And so that's the good part. But the bad part is that it has – partly because of Citizens United and partly because of loopholes – including the loopholes that Kevin is talking about, the loopholes that were so scandalously exploited by Dan Malloy and his friends in raising money for the state party from some of those sources that are supposed to be verboten. You know, we don't really have – it's called the Citizens Election Program. We call it the Clean Election Law. I don't think it's given us the clean elections. We're spending a lot of money for clean elections, not really exactly getting the things that we wanted. Some of that, because of Citizens United, was out of our control. But yeah, it's still a pretty ugly business.
I wanted to move on. I think this next thing that we're going to talk about wasn't something that even needed legislative approval, and that is, Caitlin, this DMV adds a third gender box to its form for license and ID cards. This is interesting. Now, where did this come from?
I don't know, honestly.
We don't either.
Yeah.
Well, we should say our sharp-eyed producer, Matt Dwyer, thinks it may have been – remember when Lamont had all those committees that were meeting before he took office? And they generated like, you know, X thousand different ideas. Matt feels like he remembers it from there. So that may be
where
it comes from.
Yeah, that's actually probably a great theory. They did have, I think, an entire committee devoted explicitly to – inclusion and diversity and things like that. It's a move that's, I think, becoming increasingly popular everywhere. And, you know, why not be inclusive?
And that's right. When we think about non-binary, again, this is an option for people who don't feel that their gender identity fits within the male-female binary. But what was the response at the Capitol when this was announced?
I think they've been pretty focused on other things. There's just a few other things going on there, so I haven't heard anything.
Yeah, Kevin Rennie, what did you think of this announcement?
As I'm hearing, I thought, well, there are things that an administration can do on its own, and we often forget that, and sometimes I think for a governor, it takes them a while to get used to their own authority or to become more familiar with it. And this is one of those instances. And I think I read – are there 12 other states that already have this?
Like that, yeah.
I think
we're certainly not the first.
Yeah.
Well, we're listening to The Wheelhouse. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. Colin McEnroe is here with me, as well as Kevin Rennie and Caitlin Krassel. Coming up, there was a flurry of media attention yesterday afternoon trying to confirm whether murder suspect Fotis Doulos was dead or alive. Up next, we talk about the consequences of breaking news. This is The Wheelhouse. You're listening to The Wheelhouse on Connecticut Public Radio. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. Now, Tuesday at noon, accused murderer Fotis Doulos failed to appear at an emergency bond hearing that could have sent him to jail pending trial. A short time later, reporters began tweeting that Doulos was dead, citing unnamed sources. Then later in the afternoon, Doulos' lawyer, Norm Pattis, said the Farmington man had a faint pulse and that he was being treated at the hospital. Caitlin Krassel, is this another example of what goes wrong in the rush to break news?
Yes. It is. At the same time, I hedge a little bit because my understanding, based on the news reports that have come out since then, is that they did CPR on him for like half an hour and then he somehow regained a pulse, or maybe he had it the whole time. But these are very well-sourced reporters. Dave Altmari at the Hartford Courant, I don't know him personally, but I'm impressed continually by his work. And he, I believe, was the first to report that he had died. He's a very well-sourced person. He was getting that, I believe, from lawyers. And at a certain point, you know, people who seem to have intimate knowledge of the situation, I always err on the side of caution and compassion when it comes to reporting the death of anyone. They'll be just as dead in 5 minutes as they are right now. So double-checking that is – that said – the 5 minutes, it was a half an hour between when his lawyer said he was dead and when he seem to have a pulse. So it's a tough situation.
We have that tweet from Dave Altamari at 12:30 yesterday. Law enforcement sources telling the Hartford Courant that Fotis Doulos had died at his Farmington home. Colin, what did you think of this flurry of activity yesterday?
Well, first of all, it's a long-running problem. You can date it as far back as you really want to. Certainly after 9/11, I was trying to do live talk radio after 9/11, and just incredible stories would come in, sometimes from really good sources, like congressmen would tell you stuff that just wasn't ultimately true. But there was a tremendous amount of panic and a real kind of a tendency to believe other scenarios, that there's another plane coming and there's something else that's about to happen. It really started to surface as a big problem for the press. One of the first sort of iterations of this that I remember is in the mass shooting in Norway, the Anders Breivik shooting, where there was a lot of initial reporting in the form of tweets and other kinds of social media stuff that these were Islamic terrorists. It wasn't. He was a Christian extremist. The New York Times had a lot of problems with it. If you remember the Empire State Building shooting, it was a mass shooting, which I think the Times tried to cover with some kind of running stream on their own site that it kept containing errors because there's a fog of war, you know, in all of these situations. It's true with Kobe Bryant's helicopter crash. It's true with a situation like this. So, I mean, I think you need two things. You need some kind of procedure in place for members of the media that ideally everybody would agree upon from all outlets. Like, what constitutes actionable intelligence? You know, who gets to say, you know, in a way that we're all comfortable going with it, that somebody's dead, for example. And then the other thing you need, and I mean, I'm not shifting the burden to the news consumers because it's our job and it's our job to maintain the trust of the people, and we're not doing a very good job right now. But news consumers also have to realize the things that they read in tweets, even if they're from fairly reputable journalists, represent a journalist in a very foggy situation, you know, trying to figure things out. And so I would just encourage people, don't put too much weight on that. People are very interested in whether Fotis Doulos is alive or dead. Whether or not that's a good thing or not, we could debate. But people are obsessed by knowing things like that. Well, tweets aren't a good way to find out.
Kevin Rennie, do you agree with why these mistakes continue to happen?
I think yesterday that it was an astonishing number of people were at that house in doing all sorts of things, police and medical people, and I think even a fire truck. And
I believe there was even a drone that flew
there
over.
Oh, yes. So there certainly was a drone, yes. And I can imagine after some time short of that 30 minutes that there were people in some positions of responsibility on the scene who said, "Oh, he's dead," and it spread from there. And it is remarkable that after that long a time that suddenly that there would be a faint pulse. But I it seemed like the emphasis was on faint.
I think, yeah, credit to the EMTs and whoever was, you know, working on that, because based on what I have read from these reports, again, this is not something I've covered, but it does sound like they put significant effort into reviving him
for an extended period of time.
So credit to them.
and it says something about them that they did for Fotis Doulos, someone they were undoubtedly familiar with when they got to his house and the circumstances of his life, that they did for him what they would have done for anybody.
The other thing that's important to understand here is that the reporters are getting pressure from their news desk. You got to say something. Like a reporter like Dave Altamari, who is a really good reporter, might be saying, you know, I really don't know this for sure. And he might be getting pressure from news desk. Well, everybody else is tweeting stuff. You better tweet something too. That you're not allowed to be silent. And that's a problem. That's an area of dysfunction that needs to be dealt with. It's also, I mean, one thing our own Frankie Graziano does pretty well, he does these video tweets where, I mean, it's hard to explain a complicated situation in 140 characters. So, you know, sometimes maybe it's better to do some kind of tweet where you can, or some kind of messaging where you can say, look, this is a chaotic situation. Here's what we know. Here's what we don't know. Here's what we think we might know. But, you know, and that's hard. Twitter is not a subtle medium.
His own lawyer, too, said that he was dead,
right.
Which is, I mean, not to, you know, shift the blame here. And I do think that some blame belongs with the media for this. But when you have someone as reputable as his lawyer saying that he's dead, it's a little hard to ignore.
Mm-hmm. And but I think that's an argument to have a protocol in place.
Yeah.
Who gets to deliver that news in a way that's actionable?
Yeah.
And I would say it shouldn't be a lawyer. It should be – if law enforcement says he's dead, then I think we should be able to trust that. But as an official matter, say he's dead. Mm-hmm.
What you're suggesting is never going to happen.
No. But I'm a dreamer. I
thought it was notable that throughout yesterday's events, which were unfolding right in front of us, that everyone on the scene seemed to be very mindful of Fotis Doulos' privacy in terms of putting up those covers and sheets and
except for that drone flying over his
well except for the drone yes but I mean in response to that
yes.
There were those tent covers and then when he was moved to the helicopter at UConn there were sheets up to they're holding up sheets to keep cameras away from him. But once he got to New York then privacy concerns were not as evident.
Well, we need to move on, but we should say that I think the latest is that he is still in critical condition at a New York hospital. And for people who are looking for some closure for the family, that's not really great news for them, that there will be no trial if he doesn't recover.
Yeah. I do think at the end of the day, there are children involved here, and it's heartbreaking no matter which way you look at it.
True. There's no closure.
Colin McEnroe, how about you start off our feats and grievances?
Okay, I'm going to do. I'm going to sort of continue from the vein that we're in now, sort of, and say that I had a grievance against the Washington Post. They briefly suspended or placed on administrative leave one of their reporters, Felicia Senmez, who, in all of the tweeting and all of the speculation and all the conversation about the death of Kobe Bryant, tweeted a Daily Beast article saying, reminding people of how incredibly graphic and gruesome those 2003 Vail, Colorado rape allegations were. And she was put on administrative leave. They've since rescinded that and said, no, I guess it doesn't really violate our social media policies. To me, we were taught on our first AO, but it's part of the news. And the news sometimes includes things that people might prefer not to talk about right now. And in that instance, this is a big part of the story. If that story had unfolded in the climate of Me Too, it would have been one of the worst Me Too cases imaginable. And so to sort of say that it's somehow off the table, I think, is kind of ridiculous. And just a quick sort of thumbs up to our own Mary Louise Kelly, who I think stood up to a bully this week in the form of the Secretary of State. And even yesterday, Trump and Pompeo were saying stuff about her that struck me as kind of misogynistic.
We've got less than 3 minutes. Kevin Rennie, go.
Sorry.
Well, I want to just follow up on what Colin said, because I was watching this on Sunday afternoon, sitting on my couch watching television, and Kobe Bryant knew it was part of his life story, and it certainly was not what was in the spotlight on Sunday or even since then. But our biographies are varied. What's remarkable is that he recovered from that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Part of what was remarkable is he recovered from that. But you're right; it is also remarkable at how quickly our standards and what matters changes and how we deal with them.
Caitlin Krassel.
My grievance also was with the Washington Post over that. I think it sets a dangerous precedent to suspend a reporter for reporting the news. Even if that news is not something that you like. And so that is my grievance as well.
I just wanted to circle back, fit in my grievance related to the Fotis Doulos case. I thought it was ridiculous that media outlets were breaking into regular programming to treat this accused murderer as a celebrity when we think about how many women are abused by the hands of men. Intimate partner violence is a real thing. And the next time that we think about this kind of cycle of domestic violence, would media outlets break into regular programming to report the next woman to die by the hands of her partner? I think it's something that we all need to think about. This is The Wheelhouse. I'm Lucy Nalpathanchil. Thanks to Colin McEnroe, Caitlin Krasselt, and Kevin Rennie. We'll be back next week.